Therefore, in order to seek forgiveness, the best way possible through the Quran, we will now see all the occurrences of forgiveness in the Quran through its triliteral root, Ra'in Fa Ra, which occurs 234 times in the whole Quran in 9 derived forms. In order to properly appreciate and see this, all of its occurrences have been placed into 3 pages. And that brings us to page 4, 5, and 6. This is going to be the longest part of this video and its conclusion, inshallah. As you can see, the glorious Quran is fully detailed in all the subjects that we saw, and even more. And it is also fully detailed and rich in knowledge in forgiveness. La ilaha illallah. All the subjects and verses for forgiveness from the Quran are in these 3 pages, as we will be going through them efficiently. And all the highlighted colors will be clearly explained so you can easily get your way around in this document, inshallah. Henceforth, starting with page 4, here you have 6 out of the 9 derived forms on this page. On the top of this page, you have the 65 times as the form 1, verb ghafara, to forgive, which is where I will be focusing on very soon. Then below it, towards the left, you have the 5 times as the nominal ghafar, the forgiving. And below it, once as the form 10, active participle, mustaghfirin. Then, next to it on the right, you have once as the noun rufran. And below it, twice as the active participle, ghafir. And finally, below it on this page, you have once as the form 10, verbal noun, istirfal. Therefore, let's now focus here above, the 65 times as the form 1, verb, rafara, to forgive. Everything that is highlighted in green are the prayers of forgiveness, in which you can say through the Quran. In other words, during the glorification, the tasbih, you can say any of these verses that are highlighted in green, which are all the verses that one can say or seek forgiveness through the Quran. Thus, they are very important to remember, and you have a whole lifetime to remember them all, inshallah. May our Lord increase us in knowledge. Rabbi zidni ilma. Then you have all the verses highlighted in turquoise, which are enlightening verses of forgiveness. Meaning, as you read any of them, which you should, they remind you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you for almost every situation. Thus, they are enlightening verses of forgiveness and give you a detailed explanation why He will forgive you, as well as the qualities of the believers. For example, here on the right, Surah 42 verse 37 says, "And those who avoid the greater sins and the immoralities, and when they are angry, they forgive." MashaAllah. Please read them at your own convenience and see how they are beautifully enlightening. Now, you may have noticed that I said before, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you for almost every situation, because there are a few situations in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not forgive you. And that brings us to the verses highlighted in yellow here. The first place that Allah tells us that He does not forgive you for something is in Surah 4 verse 48 and verse 116 as follows. Allah does not forgive that you associate partners with Him, but He forgives from lesser than that for whomever He wills. And whoever associates partners with Allah, then definitely he has invented a tremendous sin. This is similarly said in the same surah but at verse 116, with the ending being different as follows. Indeed, Allah does not forgive that you associate partners with Him, but He forgives lesser than that for whomever He wills. And whoever associates partners with Allah, then definitely he has strayed off, far astray. Thus, shirk, associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, idol worship, this is a tremendous sin that leads you far astray, and Allah does not forgive. Then, in the same surah, 4, but at verse 137, also says, indeed, those who believe, then disbelieve, then believe, then disbelieve, then increase in disbelief, Allah will never forgive them, nor to guide them on any way. That is another reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not forgive you, as the verse is self-explanatory. Then again, in the same surah, 4, but at verse 168 to 169 says, indeed, those who disbelieve while transgressing or committing wrong or injustice, Allah will never forgive them nor to guide them to any pathway except the pathway to hell, Jahannam, immortally therein forever, and that for Allah is easy. Hence, if you are a disbeliever and you are committing injustice or transgressing consciously, Allah does not forgive them. And that is if they die that way, and that is elaborated to us here on the right, Surah 47, Muhammad, verse 34 as follows. Indeed, those who disbelieved and repel or hinder from the way of Allah, then died while they were disbelievers, never then will Allah forgive them. Thus, dying as a disbeliever, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never forgive you. And finally, for the hypocrites, Allah does not forgive them either, as said in Surah 9 verse 80 and Surah 63, which is called hypocrites, munafiqun, at verse 6. No matter how many times you ask forgiveness for them, Allah will not forgive them. Those are the fundamental rules of forgiveness in the Quran, and Allah knows best. However, there are pre-forgiveness rules according to Allah in the glorious Quran. If you possess the knowledge of them, they are like a bypass or an exception. A very dangerous and the most famous example of this was made by some of the best, the children of Israel. And perfectly was fulfilled the word of your Lord, the best for the children of Israel, because they were patient. That was after the end of Pharaoh, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved the children of Israel. This was a great test that they went through. And then Allah made an appointment with Prophet Musa for 40 nights. And this is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manifested in brightness, tajalla, to the mountain. He made it crumble to dust, and Musa fell down unconscious. Then after, Prophet Musa awakened and glorified Allah and repented. Afterwards, Allah gave him the Furqan. And during that time, the children of Israel took the golden calf as their god. He, the Sumerian, then brought forth for them a body of a calf, for it had a mooing sound. They then said, "This is your God and the God of Musa," but he forgot. And two verses later, "And most definitely Harun, Aaron, has said to them from before, 'O my people, you are only being tested by it. And indeed, your Lord is the most gracious spirit, Ar-Rahman. So follow me and obey my command.'" They said, "We will never cease to be completely devoted to it until Musa returns to us." The children of Israel thus broke the most important commandment, the first commandment. لا تجعل مع الله إلها آخر فتقعد مذموما مخذولا. Do not make with Allah another god, lest you will sit disgracefully forsaken. But then they realized that they had definitely gone astray, so they turned, repented to Allah, as said in Surah 7 verse 149. And when it fell into their hands and they saw that they had definitely gone astray, they said, "If not our Lord has mercy on us and forgives us, we will most definitely be among the losers." Hence, the children of Israel asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy upon them and to forgive them, or else they will be among the losers. However, we saw earlier in Surah 4 verse 48 and verse 116 that Allah does not forgive that you associate partners with Him. Indeed, Allah does not forgive that you associate partners with Him, but He forgives from lesser than that for whomever He wills. And whoever associates partners with Allah, then definitely he has invented a tremendous sin. Therefore, did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive them or not when they asked for forgiveness in Surah 7 verse 149? Interestingly, Allah informs us of another rule that comes before forgiveness, as said to us in Surah 2, Baqarah, verse 51 to 52. "And when we made a promising appointment with Musa for 40 nights, then you took the calf after he left, and you were transgressors. Then we pardoned you from after that, so that you may be appreciative." Thus, the children of Israel were pardoned instead of being forgiven. To be pardoned is a step prior to forgiveness, as we will soon see. Hence, this does not break the rule that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forgive idolatry. Instead, He can pardon it. To have a better understanding of the rules of pardoning, afu, as a step before forgiveness according to the Quran, we have to see all of these occurrences in the glorious Quran as well. And that will bring us to page 7. We will be coming back to efficiently overview page 5 and 6 concerning the rest of the knowledge of forgiveness, inshallah. So here in page 7, you are looking at the triliteral root Ayn Fa Waw, which occurs 35 times in the whole Quran in 4 derived forms. On the top left, you have the 27 times as the form 1, Afa, to pardon. And on the top right, you have the 5 times as the noun Afu, pardoning. Just below it, you have twice as the noun Afu, surplus or excess. And finally below that, once as the active participle Afin, those who pardon. You will notice that pardon is always before forgiveness in every verse in which to pardon and forgive is mentioned. The first place that pardon and forgive is mentioned together is actually a prayer that we should say, and it is also a well-known verse, the last verse of the biggest surah, Baqarah, verse 286, as follows. Allah does not charge his soul except to its capacity. For it is what it earned, and against it is what it earned. Our Lord, do not hold us responsible if we forget or make a mistake. Our Lord, do not lay upon us a load like what you laid it upon those who were from before us. Our Lord, and do not lay on us what we do not have the strength for it. And pardon us, and forgive us, and have mercy upon us. You are our protector, so support us against the disbelieving people. This is the only prayer through the Quran that one asks to be pardoned and forgiven and seeks mercy. Subhanallah. And that is why you see it in green here. Note, pardon is mentioned before forgiveness. In Surah 3, verse 159, Allah tells the Prophet to pardon and ask for forgiveness for those who turned away on the day the two armies met, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had pardoned them a few verses before. Surah 3, verse 155. The other place in the Quran that pardon and forgive is mentioned together is in Surah 64, verse 14, which is also the last place pardon is said in the Quran as follows. O you who believe, indeed, among your spouses and your children are enemies to you, so beware of them. But if you pardon and overlook and forgive, then indeed Allah is forgiving, merciful. Your spouses and your children can be your enemies. What is interesting is that if you pardon and overlook and forgive, then indeed Allah is forgiving, merciful. So here again, as you can see, to pardon is always before forgiving. And this verse is highlighted in yellow because it's a situation where you should pardon and to alert you. Additionally, everything that you see highlighted in yellow are the conditions in which you should pardon or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pardons. So it is important that you go through them in order to have an excellent understanding of what those conditions are. The subjects are in parentheses. And to certify that pardon is before forgiveness, although the verses above prove it, here on the right, the five times as the noun afu, pardoning, four out of five verses here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pardoning, forgiving, and not forgiving, pardoning. Thus, he is pardoning first, then forgiving. The other name or attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is paired with pardoning is powerful, qadira, here in Surah 4, verse 149. Now, you may have noticed earlier that in Surah 64, verse 14, between pardoning and forgiving was to overlook. O you who believe, indeed, among your spouses and your children are enemies to you, so beware of them. But if you pardon and overlook and forgive, then indeed Allah is forgiving, merciful. This is telling us that to overlook comes between pardoning and forgiving. That is why you have all of its occurrences in the Quran below here on the same page, page 7, which is triliteral root, sad, fa, ha, which occurs 8 times in the whole Quran in 2 derived forms. So here you have all the examples of overlooking, yasfah, in the Quran. And you will notice that to overlook is always after pardoning. Here you have the example of the children of Israel breaking their covenant, and thus Allah cursed them and made their hearts hard. They were also distorting the words of Allah from their places, and they had forgotten a fortunate part thereof, in which they were reminded of it. And you will not cease to observe betrayal from them, except a few of them. Thus, in the end of this verse says, but pardon them and overlook. Indeed, Allah loves the virtuous. So here in Surah 5, Maida, verse 13, to pardon then overlook are qualities of the muhsineen, the virtuous. MashaAllah. Then in Surah 24, verse 22, and do not let those who possess bounty and plenty among you swear off giving near relatives and the needy and the immigrants in the way of Allah, but let them pardon and let them overlook. Do you not love that Allah should forgive you? And Allah is forgiving, most merciful. Here in Surah 24, verse 22, it clearly informs us that to pardon and overlook, Allah forgives you. Alhamdulillah. And we saw Surah 64, verse 14 earlier, as pardon and overlooking is prior to forgiving. Therefore, to pardon is intertwined with overlooking. Thus, if you pardon the people, you become among the pardoners, as said in Surah 3, verse 134, here on the right. Those who spend or expend, yunfiqun, during ease and hardship, and who restrain anger, and the pardoners of mankind, and Allah loves the virtuous. Those are thus the qualities of the virtuous, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the virtuous. Muhsineen. Interestingly, in Surah 3, verse 134, as it says in the beginning of the verse, those who expend or expend, yunfiqun, this is a very important deed that we are told to do. And in Surah 2, verse 215, it says, They ask you what they should spend. Yunfiqun. Say, whatever you spend of khayr, good, best, excellent, is then for the parents, dual, and the near relatives, and the orphans, and the poor, and the traveler, the wayfarer, and whatever you do of khayr, good, best, excellent, then indeed, Allah has knowledge of it. So this verse is talking about what you should spend of khayr, which means of good, best, or excellent, for those mentioned in the order of 1 to 5. Then if you go 4 verses later, 219, which is here in the middle right of this document, starting from the 15th Arabic word, it says, and they ask you what they should spend, yunfiqun, expend. Say, bi'afu, the surplus, the excess or abundance. Thus, Allah explains to you the verses so that you may ponder concerning the world and the hereafter. This verse continues and talks about the orphans. Therefore, we must spend or expend from our surplus or excess or beyond needs, abundance. Bi'afu, to our parents, then the near relatives and the orphans and the poor and the traveler. And it does not need to be money exactly. In Surah 76, in Sun, verse 8, it is food to the poor and the orphans and the captives. In the beginning of the Quran, Surah 2, verse 3, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, and out of what we provided for them, they spend. Yunfiqun, expend. Expend means to spend or use up a resource such as money, time, or energy. In Surah 2, verse 267, O you who believe, spend or expend from the good things which you have earned, and from that what we brought forth for you from the earth, and do not aim at the bad things to spend or expend therefrom, while you would not take it except with closed eyes therein. And know that Allah is rich, praiseworthy. Thus we have efficiently overviewed page 7, as the laws of pardoning is prior to forgiving, and the only prayer in the Quran that one can ask concerning pardon also involves forgiving and mercy, as that is in Surah 2, verse 286, the last verse, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pardoning, forgiving, and pardoning powerful, or fully capable, and that pardoning is part of overlooking, which is a quality of the virtuous, muhsinin, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the muhsinin, the virtuous, and the noun afu means also surplus or excess, as we saw its clear example in Surah 2, verse 219. Subhanallahi rabbil alameen. This now brings us to page 5, as we will continue seeing the laws of forgiveness, in which page 4 contain all the verses of forgiveness which one can seek, highlighted in green and so on, among the 65 times as the form 1, verb rafara, to forgive. We will see the rest of the derived forms later, inshallah. So here on page 5, you have the 40 times as the form 10, verb istaghfara, ask or seek forgiveness, and below it, the 28 times as the noun maghfira, forgiveness. Starting with the 28 times as a noun, maghfira, forgiveness. These are all the verses in the Quran that forgiveness is mentioned. In here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs us of he or she that deserves his forgiveness. Those are the verses that are highlighted in turquoise here. Now pay attention to these golden verses. Surah 3 verse 133 and Surah 57 verse 21. So first Surah 3 verse 133. And hasten towards forgiveness from your Lord and a garden or paradise, it's with it is the heavens and the earth prepared for the God-fearing or God-conscious. In Surah 57 verse 21, be foremost, sabiqu, towards forgiveness from your Lord and a garden or paradise, its witheth is like the witheth of the heaven and the earth prepared for those who believe in Allah and His Messenger. That is the bounty of Allah. He gives it to whomever He wills, and Allah is the possessor of the tremendous bounty. These two verses both describe two different gardens, paradises. As I said in the beginning of this video, there are two paradises, and in Surah 3 verse 133, you have the dimensions of the paradise for the companions of the right, Ashabul Naimana, and for the foremost of the foremost, Sabiqun As-Sabiqun. The dimensions of their paradise is in Surah 57, Hadid verse 21. Thus, forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes with a paradise that is absolutely beyond our imagination, and it is worth hastening for, and inshallah, being foremost. But if you look at the verse before Surah 57 verse 21, verse 20, which reminds us of this life as a delusion as follows. Know that the worldly life is but a play or game, and an amusement, an adornment, and boasting between you. and the proliferation, which is a rapid increase in numbers, of wealth and children. The example is like a rain whose vegetation impresses the disbelievers. Then it withers, dries, and you see it turning yellow. Then it becomes broken orts, debris. And in the hereafter, there is a severe punishment and forgiveness from Allah and good pleasure or approval. However, the worldly life is but the joy of delusion. Thus, forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be a priority to seek. That is highlighted in yellow here as an alert. And so are the other verses highlighted in yellow. Please read them. Note Surah 2 verse 268 here. Satan promises you poverty and commands you to the immorality, while Allah promises you forgiveness from him and bounty. And Allah is encompassing, knowing. Hence, Satan is inviting us to hell and Allah invites us to paradise and forgiveness. Just like it says at the end of this verse, Surah 2 verse 221 here. Now these two verses that are highlighted in green give us an important insight of attaining forgiveness. You can only warn him who follows the remembrance and who fears the most gracious spirit, Ar-Rahman, in the unseen. So give him the good tidings of forgiveness and an honorable reward. Indeed, those who fear their Lord in the unseen, for them is forgiveness and an honorable reward. Fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the unseen is a trait of those attaining forgiveness and an honorable reward, paradise. Finally, what is in dark green here is an allegorical description of paradise in Surah Muhammad 47, verse 15. And that covers the noun maghfirah, forgiveness, which is important to have in mind, inshallah. The subject of forgiveness will be ending with the 40 times as the form 10 verb istaghfara, ask or seek forgiveness here above. But before we see that, you may have noticed that there are these two stars here. They are indicating Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's different attribute or name with forgiveness. In Surah 13 verse 6, he is surely possessor of forgiveness. And in Surah 74 verse 56, the source of the forgiveness. Thus, before concluding the topic of forgiveness, here above, we will see all the places that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the forgiving in the Quran. Page 6, and then back to page 5 and finish seeing the 40 times as the form 10 verb istaghfara, ask or seek forgiveness, inshallah. So here on page 6, you have all 91 occurrences of the nominal rafu, forgiving, in the Quran. Indeed, the Quran is surely fully detailed, mufassala, and incredibly rich in knowledge. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All 91 occurrences of the nominal rafu, forgiving, is directly in reference to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name and attribute, the forgiving. As you can see, his name and attribute, the forgiving, dominates in blue with gold font in it. Many of these verses are pretty big verses, and their subjects are therefore in parentheses. Highlighted in yellow are alert verses, such as what is haram, forbidden, and halal, permitted, and so on. What is highlighted in pink are verses related to women mainly, such as marriage, divorce, dress code, and so on. What is important to keep in mind here is that all the verses with their situations, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forgiving and in favor to that, whichever subject. You will note that his name and attribute forgiving is almost always paired with another one of his name and attribute. And the ones that have stars next to them are all the different attributes with forgiving. So the first one here, Surah 2 verse 173, is the first place in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forgiving, merciful. This is also the most repeated pair among the 91 total occurrences. Then in the same surah, 2, Baqarah, but verse 225, he is forgiving, forbearing. And in surah 4, verse 43, Allah is pardoning, forgiving. Then in surah 6, verse 165, he is surely forgiving, merciful. And then in surah 10, verse 107, he is the forgiving, the merciful. In surah 17, verse 25, he is for those who are wab, repeatedly glorify and praise, forgiving. Also in Surah 17, but verse 44, he is forbearing, forgiving, the reverse of Surah 2, verse 225. And in Surah 18, verse 58, he is the forgiving, owner of the mercy. And in Surah 22, verse 60, he is surely pardoning, forgiving. Now in Surah 34, verse 2, he is the merciful, the forgiving, the reverse of Surah 10, verse 107. In the same Surah 34, but verse 15, he is called a forgiving Lord. In Surah 35, verse 28, Allah is Almighty, forgiving. And two verses later, Surah 35, verse 30, he is forgiving, appreciative. And four verses later, Surah 35, verse 34, he is surely forgiving, appreciative. Then here below, Surah 67, verse 2, he is the Almighty, the forgiving. And the last place here in Surah 85, Buruj, verse 14, He is the forgiving, the most loving. This is also the last place in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forgiving and the most loving. Subhanallah. Therefore, going through all these verses, you will have a fully detailed, self-explanatory description of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name and attribute, the forgiving, as well as a detailed explanation of our Lord being the forgiving paired with the other 16 names and attributes that we saw. Please read them inshallah and know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is indeed the forgiving. Now, this brings us back to page 5 at the 40 times as the form 10, verb istarfara, ask or seek forgiveness. Here we are told to ask for forgiveness, and the verses highlighted in yellow are alert verses, which informs us that there is no point of asking forgiveness for the hypocrites as well as the idol worshippers, mushrikeen, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not forgive them. All the verses highlighted in turquoise are enlightening verses and excellent examples of seeking forgiveness. And remember, the page before this one, page 4, all the verses highlighted in green are the prayers of forgiveness that are said. And you should say, here in page 5, all that is highlighted in green are additional information that we should know while asking for forgiveness, such as asking for forgiveness for our misdeeds, sins, and for the believers, which is said in Surah 40, verse 55, and Surah Muhammad, verse 19 here. And another additional information that is highlighted in green here while asking for forgiveness is to repent thereafter. That is told to us in these verses in Surah 11 here. They all similarly say, ask forgiveness of your Lord, then repent to Him. Thus, we must repent after we sought forgiveness. And that brings us to page 8. Here you are looking at all 87 occurrences of the root word of repentance, the triliteral root tawaba, in the whole Quran in 7 derived forms. Here you have the 63 times as the form 1 verb taba, to repent, to turn, or to redeem. This is where we will see how to repent. So here below, towards the left, you have the 12 times as the active participle tawab. Here, all the occurrences are in direct reference to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a tawab, which is either translated as the redeemer or the acceptor of repentance or the oft returning, for the exception of Surah 2 verse 222, as it says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's attribute, indeed Allah loves the repenters. And below that, you have the two derived forms here, once as the adjective ta'ibat, which is in pink, indicating believing woman qualities, and once as the noun taub, again in reference to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then below that, twice as the noun matab, a return in repentance. Here on the right, you have the 7 times as the noun tauba, repentance. And finally here, below on the right, you have the once as the active participle taibun, those who turn in repentance, or the repenters. The color coding here is pretty much the same as what was explained for forgiveness earlier, which brought us here, and that was these verses that are highlighted in green here. These verses in Surah 11, in which they all similarly say, and ask forgiveness of your Lord, then repent to Him. So after thoroughly analyzing all their occurrences, you have three verses that tells us how to repent, and they are Surah 2 verse 128, Surah 7 verse 143, and Surah 46 verse 15, highlighted in green. Starting with Surah 2 verse 128, which is a verse in which Prophet Ibrahim is making a very well-known prayer along with his son Prophet Ismail, as it ends at verse 129 as follows. Our Lord, make us both submitters, surrenderers to You, Muslimaini laka. And from our descendants, let there be a submissive, surrendering nation to You, and show us our rules of worship, manasikana, and redeem us or accept our repentance, watuba alayna. Indeed, you are the Redeemer, the accepting of repentance, the Merciful. Our Lord, raise up within them a messenger from them to recite to them Your verses, and will teach them the scripture and the wisdom, and cleanse them. Indeed, you are the Almighty, the Wise. La ilaha illallah. Here you have the first way to seek repentance, as it says, and redeem us or accept our repentance. Indeed, you are the Redeemer or the accepting of repentance, the most merciful. Therefore, our rules of worship, manasikana, such as the tasbih, which is a form of worship, as we are purely worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it contains rules of worship, such as to glorify with the praise of our Lord, with our hands as well, pardon, overlook, and seek forgiveness. which brought us to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And verse 129 clearly exposes the truth of this. Then the next place we have an example to seek repentance is in Surah 7 verse 143, which is when Prophet Musa asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to see him. His Lord manifested in brightness to the mountain. He made it crumble to dusk and Musa fell down unconscious. Then when he awakened, he said, "Glory be to you, I repent to you, and I am the first of the believers." We had seen this example in the Salat video, and this is another way to repent. And the last place we are told how to repent is in Surah 46 verse 15, as we should say during maturity and at the age of 40 or before, as follows. And we have enjoined, instructed upon man to his parents excellence. His mother carried him with hardship and gave birth to him with hardship, and his bearing and his weaning is 30 months until when he reaches his maturity and reaches 40 years. He says, "My Lord, enable me the power that I may be appreciative for your favor which you have favored upon me and upon my parents, and to do righteousness of which pleases you, and make righteous for me among my offspring. Indeed, I have repented to you, and indeed, I am of the surrenderers, submitters, Muslimin." That is the final and most descriptive verse to say to repent. Hence, we have completed how to seek repentance through the Quran, as it is the step after seeking forgiveness. Please see in this page all the conditions to seek repentance as well, inshallah. And that brings us back to page 5, at the 40 times, as the form 10 verb, istarfara, ask or seek forgiveness. May our Lord increase our knowledge. We are almost done, and you will be seeing a video of me applying a summary of everything that was presented in this video, inshallah. But before we see that, here is a quick summary of the tasbih that we saw. So, as one stands for the tasbih, during the tasbih time frames, facing the Qibla, then initiate it by saying Subhanak Allahumma, glory be to you, O Allah, in Surah 10 verse 10, while raising both hands as Prophet Zakaria demonstrated, which meant to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, similar to the motions of the birds with their wings outspread. Thus, you have now started the tasbih, glorification. Then, the simplest way to glorify our Lord with His praise is Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah. Glory be to Allah, praise be to Allah, there is no God but Allah. Then you can say other verses that you see highlighted in green in page 1 for glorifying Allah and page 3 for praising Allah. And in the second part of this video, we will be seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's most excellent names in full detail as a special bonus. Patience is the key. And remember, the best prayer to say while changing positions during the tasbih is in Surah 10 verse 10, which is, "Glory be to you, O Allah, subhanak Allahumma." This is for those who enter Jannatul Na'im, the blissful paradise, the highest paradise. And then prostrate on the chin by saying, Subhana Rabbina, in kana wa'adu Rabbina la maf'aula. Glory be to our Lord, indeed, the promise of our Lord must be fulfilled. And then come to the kneeling position, and then glorify Allah again by saying, Glory be to our Lord, the tremendous. Subhana Rabbina Azim, with the hands raised up. And then the second prostration, as mentioned in Surah 17 verse 109 on the chin, and glorify again by saying Subhana Rabbina al-A'la, glory be to our Lord, the Most High. And then you come back to the standing position to finalize the tasbih. And the best prayer to begin finalizing the glorification is by saying Alhamdulillahi Rabbin Alameen, as is also said in Surah 10 verse 10. And finally, this brings us to the last step, seeking forgiveness during the tasbih, glorification, and the echo or repeat glorifying, Awwab. In case you want to glorify Allah even more before you seek His forgiveness, which you can as much as you want, but if you want to end the tasbih, you must seek forgiveness as we just saw how, as well as to repent thereafter. And now, back to where we were. During this process of seeking forgiveness, then repenting, this is where the tasbih will be ending. That is said to us as an exemplary example through Prophet David in Surah 38 verse 24. The tasbih ends with the kneeling position. We had thoroughly seen this as well in the Salat video because this proved that we must kneel and not bow as follows. He said, "Certainly, he has wronged you by demanding your ewe with his ewes. And surely, most partners definitely treat each other unfairly except those who believe and do righteous deeds. And these are so few. And David thought that we had tested him. He then implored his Lord for forgiveness and he fell down kneeling. And he turned penitent. Wa'anab." Thus, when Prophet David asked for forgiveness and he fell down kneeling, he then did the anab. He turned penitent. Therefore, after seeking forgiveness during the tasbih, the best example is to then fall down kneeling and turn penitent. One who turns penitent is one who is feeling or showing sorrow and regret for having done wrong, repentant. And it is also a person who repents their sins or wrongdoings and seeks forgiveness from God. Note the next two verses. So we forgave him for that, and indeed, for him is a near access in our presence and an excellent place of return. Ma'abin. O David, Dawood, indeed, we have made you a Khalifa in the earth. So wisely judge between mankind with the truth, and do not follow the opinion, the desire, al-hawa, for it will lead you astray from the way of Allah. Indeed, those who go astray from the way of Allah, for them is a severe punishment, because they forgot the day of account, reckoning. Thus, after Prophet David asked for forgiveness, he kneeled and turned penitent. Anab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave him and made him Khalifa, and gave him a crucial advice to not follow the opinion, the desire, al-hawa, for it will lead you astray from the way of Allah. Hence, one must follow facts, proofs only. Therefore, after seeking forgiveness with the proofs on page 4, we are to repent as well, and that is also best to be done while kneeling, as we saw what can be said in page 8. And now, we will see the best way to turn penitent with Quranic proofs, as the Quran is fully detailed. This now brings us to the last page, page 9, to see how to be and what to say during the anab, penitent. So here on page 9, you have all the occurrences of the root word for penitent, anab, in the Quran. The triliteral root, nun, waw, ba, which occurs 18 times in the whole Quran in two derived forms. On the top left, you have the 11 times of the form 4, verb anab, turn penitent. And on its right, you have the 7 times of the form 4, active participle, munib, penitent. Starting with the 7 times of the form 4, active participle, munib, penitent. Here it tells us how we should be while turning penitent, which is highlighted in green. The last verse here, Surah 50, verse 33, as follows. Whosoever fears the Most Gracious Spirit, Ar-Rahman, in the unseen, and comes with a penitent heart, biqalbin munib. The verses that come before and after this verse describe paradise that is reserved for them, those who come with a penitent heart. So this is an emotion from within, and then here on the left, the verses that are highlighted in green are what we can say. So the first example here is Messenger Shu'aib in Surah 11, Hud, verse 88, as follows. He said, O my people, can you see, if I am upon a clear evidence from my Lord, and he has provided me with an excellent provision from him, and I do not want to differ from you in that which I prohibit you about it, and I do not want except to righteously reform as much as I am able. And my success is not but through Allah. Upon him I trust, and to him I turn penitent. Unib. MashaAllah. Here in the last sentence, in this verse, tells us what we can say. The next place in the Quran is in Surah 42, verse 10, as follows. And whatever you differ or disagree therein of anything, then its wise ruling is to Allah. That is Allah, my Lord. Upon him I put my trust, and to him I turn penitent. SubhanAllah. Here you have another beautiful verse that tells us what we can say. And finally, the last place in the Quran that tells us what we can say while turning penitent, and it is also an excellent example, is in Surah 60, verse 4 to 6, as follows. Definitely there has been an excellent example, Uswatun Hasana, in Ibrahim and those with him, when they said to their people, indeed, we are disassociated from you and from whatever you worship other than Allah. We disbelieve in you, and there has appeared between us and between you enmity and hatred forever until you believe in Allah alone, billahi wahdah. Except for the saying of Ibrahim to his father, I will most definitely ask forgiveness for you, but I have no power for you anything against Allah. Our Lord, upon you we trust, and to you we turn penitent, anabana, and to you is the final destination. Our Lord, do not make us a test or a trial for the disbelievers, and forgive us our Lord. Indeed you are the Almighty, the Wise. Most definitely, there is for you, through them, an excellent example, Uswatun Hasana. For whoever is hopeful in Allah and the Last Day, and whoever turns away, then indeed, Allah, He is the richest, the praiseworthy. Alhamdulillah. This is the verse that I recite from the end of Surah 60, verse 4, to verse 5, as it is an excellent example, best example, Uswatun Hasana. This is similarly said for Prophet Muhammad in Surah 33 verse 21. Thus, he is also an excellent example through the Quran alone. Subhanallah. Note, Prophet Ibrahim and those with him are being acknowledged to us, and he is also known for this quality as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us in Surah 11 verse 75 here on the right as follows. Indeed, Ibrahim was surely forbearing, tender-hearted or compassionate, penitent. Therefore, ending the tasbih with a kneeling position, then repenting and being penitent with the verses that we saw is how one should conclude the tasbih, the glorification. Since the Quranic verses were only recited during the tasbih, a basic rule in Surah 32 verse 15 must be applied at the end, which this surah is called prostration, and says, the only people who believe in our verses are those who, when they are reminded of them, fall down prostrating, and they glorify with the praise of their Lord without any arrogance. Hence, after the kneeling position, which is ending the tasbih, and then repenting and being penitent with the verses that we saw, finalize with the prostration as the verses of our Lord were recited. La ilaha illallah. We have thus completed the tasbih. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you for your patience and increase us in knowledge and guidance and admit us into His mercy in this life and the hereafter among the righteous ones. Indeed, His knowledge and mercy encompasses all things. And may our Lord continue to bless us and allow us to worship Him alone the best ways possible and facilitate our affairs. Indeed, He is seer of the servants.